Good morning. I'm Dottie Thompson. Please join me in the opening prayer. Oh God, you are our light and our salvation. Living in your presence, we have nothing to fear. Please open our hearts to your word this day as we hear the words from the prophet Isaiah and sing songs of praise to you. Please make us ready to follow Jesus on whatever path he leads us. Lord, may we cast aside our fears and doubts, and may we learn to trust wholly in you. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome to the United Methodist Church in Springfield, Colorado. I don't know that there are any announcements. I don't think so. Okay. Can you please join me with the call to worship? God has called us to leave our comfortable ways and venture forward with him.
Loving Lord, we are so often afraid. It is easier for us to remain bound to our habits.
Jesus knows our fears and offers you healing and hope for the journey.
Lord, please open our spiritual eyes and teach us your ways. We praise and worship you this day with grateful hearts.
Amen. And please join with me in the affirmation of the faith on 886 if you happen to have one. We believe in God,
creator of the world and of all people,
and Jesus Christ, incarnate among us,
who died and rose again,
and the Holy Spirit, present with us to guide, strengthen, and comfort.
We believe God will help our unbelief.
We rejoice in every sign of God's kingdom, in the upholding of human dignity and community, in every expression of love, justice, and reconciliation, in each act of self-giving on behalf of others, in the abundance of God's gifts, entrust us to all who have enough in all responsible use of the earth's resources.
Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace.
We confess our sins, individual and collective, by silence or action, through the violation of human dignity based on race, class, age, sex, nation, or faith, through the exploitation of people because of greed and indifference, through the misuse of power in personal, communal, national, and international life, through the search for security by those military and economic forces that threaten human existence, through the abuse of technology which endangers the earth and all life upon it.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
We commit ourselves individually and as a community to the way of Christ, to take up the cross, to seek abundant life for all humanity, to struggle for peace and with justice and freedom, and to risk ourselves in faith, hope, and love, praying that God's kingdom may come.
Thy kingdom come, on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
And we're going to have a hymn of worship. Come thou, Almighty King.
Thank you. time for joys and concerns, and I know that the Webbs are here, and Cheryl shared with Marty this week. We prayed for Charlie. Why is that hard? We prayed for Charlie the horse last week, and Charlie horse is doing well. So I just want you to know God answers prayer even with horses, and so he can do that with people as well. Any other joys here that the three or six of us that are gathered here spread out, that you have any joys or concerns? I know that Laura texted me this morning, and most of you know the Bill's up in Denver and taking some treatments, but he also fell a couple times, got an infection, and he's on medication for that. So please lift up Bill and Laura, keep them in your prayers. And please keep Ron and Pam in your prayers and the family. And we have a friend, Brigetta, back in Ohio, that's starting. We're going to talk to the oncologist tomorrow to see how her journey progresses. Keep Joanne. I saw her husband this week, or yesterday, or Friday, I guess. And please keep her in your prayers. And there's a whole list of others. The Methodist Church needs our support and our prayers because the decision's going to be made hopefully this year. And also for our new elected officers, the officials that are going to make decisions that impact on all of our lives, please keep them in your prayers and thoughts. For first responders, for schools and teachers and workers and kids and families, and healthcare workers, personal concerns that you might have. And we have some friends that lost a loved one this week, also back in Ohio, and Lytics and the Orrs as well. Let's have a moment of silent prayer and let the Lord remind us of his faithfulness, that he's with us, he's with those that we care about and those that I need our support and prayer. Let's take a moment and reflect on that. Then we'll pray, and then we'll pray the family prayer. Father, throughout the Word, throughout your scriptures, the Bible, you remind folks like us to not be afraid. You remind us that you're with us. So please do that again today. We thank you that that's good news. We don't have to go through life alone. We don't have to wonder if anyone cares about us or knows what's in our heart or our lives. You know, and you care, and you love. And we're glad about that. Lord, you have come seeking us, looking neither for wealthy or wise. You just ask us to follow Jesus with faith and trust. There are places where we work and where we live, and you're there too, Lord. We saw that you worked in our week this past week, and we know that you're going to be with each person this week as well. Thank you again for the sunrise and the sunset and showing us that your mercy is new every day. The Word tells us, great is your faithfulness. Lord, we know that you hear our cries and respond in love, those that we've mentioned, those that are on our heart and filtering through our brain. Please remind us, Lord, that you are a caring God that loves us and has a plan and a purpose, that you work in prayer as we ask for healing and mercy and your blessings. Extra strength for those that are out and about every day facing stresses beyond themselves. Please help them to recognize they can't do it alone, that they have to trust, and hopefully they trust you, and that we do too. And so, Lord, we offer these prayers and our concerns. We offer our lives also, trusting in your love to call us and respond with confidence to know that you have a plan and a purpose. We're grateful that you hear us, Lord, and that your will can be accepted in our lives. And as we pray this prayer in just a moment, that the things in heaven can be done on earth. We give you thanks for that, Lord. Thanks for victory that we have in Jesus. In his name we pray, who taught us to say these words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you again for all of you that have been contributing to our ministry here at Springfield First United Methodist Church. There's ways of doing that. You can mail it in to Post Office Box 193 here in Springfield. You can go online and send it. And we appreciate all of your gifts and offerings and tithes. And we're believing God will bless you, and the church will continue to serve in this community and around the world. Would you bow your hearts with me in prayer? God of deliverance, we pause during this time of worship to return to you some of the monetary riches that you've given to us. While we wait in silence, we're reminded that our hearts and minds need to be set on you and steadfast towards you. You alone are our rock and our refuge and our fortress. You alone are our salvation. Lord, we experience comforting peace in your refuge. Please bless these gifts and these offerings in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. And so we sing.
Thank you. Good morning, my name is Krista Ricker, and I have Grayson and Satchel here with me. And we are going to talk today a little about worry and prayer. So I'm just going to ask you boys if there's anything that you ever worry about.
I worry about not getting my schoolwork done on time.
Okay. Grayson, do you ever have any worries?
No.
That's the joy of being free. So most of us have things that we worry about sometimes. Sometimes they might be little things, like getting our schoolwork done on time, or they might be really big things in our lives, like if we have family members who are sick. I know we've had the boys' papa has been sick for a while, and that's been a big worry for us. And the Bible tells us, do not worry about anything, but pray about everything. And that sounds really easy, but it's not really that easy sometimes to not worry about anything. But we can train ourselves when we feel that worry coming on to start praying. And when I do that, it definitely makes me feel better because I know that now God knows what my worries are and that He's helping. Do you ever pray when you're worried?
Yes.
How about you, Gray?
No.
I know Satchel prays when he's worried a lot, and so do I. Sometimes we worry, like I said, about those big things, and a lot of times people pray about that, but we don't always think about praying for those little things. But I have a story about when I was praying about something just yesterday morning that was kind of little, but it was big to us at the time. So the boys and I went to Amarillo on Friday, and we did some fun things and spent the night. And it was just me and these two guys, so I was the only adult and driver. So when I woke up yesterday morning, I had a really bad headache. And sometimes when I get bad headaches, they do not go away for many hours, and it makes it hard for me to see, and I get really nauseous and feel like I'm going to throw up. So I started worrying, how am I going to drive 3 hours home with this bad headache? And then I thought, okay, I better start praying. So I prayed while I was in the shower, and I prayed while we were packing, and I prayed while we drove to Walmart to find some headache medicine, and I prayed while we were waiting on our food, and Satchel started praying for my headache, and I texted my mom, and she started praying for my headache, and by the time we finished eating and were ready to go home, that headache was gone. And that's a big miracle for me, because sometimes they might last 4, 6, 8 hours and make me so, so sick. So even though that was kind of a small thing, just a headache, I started praying about it and tried to not worry so much. And God really listened to all of our prayers and helped with that. So whenever we are worried about something, we should try to let God take control of that for us. Right? God, we thank you so much that you hear our prayers and that you care about us enough to listen to those big worries in our lives and also to those little worries. And we thank you that you just take over so that we don't have to feel like all those worries are on our shoulders. Thank you for listening to us and for caring about us and loving us. In your son's name, amen.
Our scripture reading today is Isaiah 40, 15 to 31. Surely the nations are like a drop in a bucket. They are regarded as dust on the scales. He weighs the islands as though they were fine dust. Lebanon is not sufficient for altar fires, nor its animals enough for burnt offerings. Before him, all the nations are as nothing. They are regarded by him as worthless and less than nothing. With whom, then, will you compare God? To what image will you liken him? As for an island, a metal worker casts it, and a goldsmith overlays it with gold and fashions silver chains for it. A person too poor to present such an offering selects wood that will rot. They look for a skilled worker to set up an idol that will not topple. Do you not know? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood since the earth was founded? He sits enthroned upon the circle of the earth, and its people are all like grasshoppers. He stretches out the heavens like a canopy and spreads them out like a tent pavilion. He brings princes to naught and reduces the rulers of the world to nothing. No sooner are they planted, no sooner are they sown, and no sooner do they take root in the ground than he blows on them and they wither. And a whirlwind sweeps them away like chaff. To whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal? Says the Holy One, lift up your eyes and look to the heavens, who created all these, he who brings out the starry host one by one and calls forth each of them by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. Why do you complain, Jacob? Why do you say, Israel, my way is hidden from the world, my cause is discomfited by my God? Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youth grow tired and weary, and men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let's pray. Father, please help me to say the right words, and please help our hearts to be open to what your Spirit wants to say to us. Thank you for all the folks that have helped today in the service, and we're believing that you're going to walk with us and enlighten us and anoint us that we can bless somebody else. And we give you thanks for your word that's powerful. In Jesus' name, amen. A certain man went through the forest and looked for a bird or an animal that he could find, and he found one. He saw a young eagle, and he took it home, and he raised it with his chickens. I was visiting, I think, a week or so ago. When I was walking the dog, I went by the Walker's house and saw their delightful chickens, and I thought, whoa, do those look big and plump? And then Ben told me they don't eat them. They are just egg layers or retired. But this man took his young eaglet home and raised him as a chicken. And you may have heard the story. And for months and months, that eagle grew up thinking that he was a chicken, eating the chicken food and doing the things that chickens do. And a naturalist came by and noticed that that eagle was in the yard, and asked the farmer, why does he have an eagle in that pen with the chickens? He said, don't you know that's an eagle? He said, no, he might be an eagle, but he thinks he's a chicken. It's a chicken and it'll never fly. And so the naturalist said, I want to give a test to show you that it's an eagle, and once he knows that he's an eagle, he won't act like a chicken any longer. Well, the next day, the naturalist came back, and he took the eagle and put him on the top of the roof of the house there, and still within view of the chickens, and he said, "Eagle, you're an eagle. Go fly like God has created you." And of course, the eagle looked down. He saw his friends, the chickens, eating the seed on the ground, and he plopped down and started eating just like the chicken. And the farmer said, "See, he's a chicken. He thinks he's a chicken." And the naturalist said, "No, he's an eagle. Let's give him another chance." And so he came back the next day, and this time he took him to the base of a mountain, and away from the farm, or away from the city, away from anything that would distract. And he said to the eagle, "Eagle, you're an eagle, and you need to fly." And of course, the eagle was kind of ruffling his feathers and didn't really understand what was going on. And the naturalist lifted him up and showed him the sun coming up over the horizon. And it started stirring something up in the eagle. And the naturalist said, "You're an eagle." And he pointed the eagle's head towards the sun and said, "God has called you to be an eagle, to fly above all of this stuff. God's created you to enjoy creation, but not at ground level, but to be high in the air as eagles are." And so he looked up, the eagle did, towards the sun, and this naturalist noticed that he started flapping his wings and screeching like an eagle, and before long he flew away and he never came back. And the moral of the story is, this was taken from a parable of the eagle from West Africa. The moral of the story is, sometimes we live among chickens, or we live among non-believers, or we live among people that don't understand what God's doing. And God is saying to us, like he did for the children of Israel, which God read just a moment ago, that God's created us for something better, something, a purpose that will help us to get through life. When, like Krista said a moment ago, when we're worried, or when we're concerned about issues and things that are beyond us, God reminds us that he's got a better plan, that we can trust him, and that we can do the things that he's created us to do. In the scripture that Dottie read, the Leadership Bible said, shows us that there's 66 chapters in Isaiah. Some of you knew that. But the first 39, like the Old Testament, there's 39 Old Testament books and 27 New Testament books. The first 39 chapters in Isaiah deal kind of like the law, that God's judgment is imminent. And we see in this chapter, in chapter 40, in the book of Isaiah, that there's a turning, that God is asking, who can compare with me? And it's kind of a rhetorical question, these questions that God's asking, because we don't know. We don't know how creation came about. We don't know what God's plan and purposes are. We don't know what the end's going to be, except that it's going to be something special that God's made. And so throughout Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah was reminding the children of Israel, God's chosen people, that they were called for a purpose, not just to be self-sufficient and take care of themselves because they knew God was faithful, but to be a witness to the nations. And that's what God's called you and I to be as well. So Isaiah today, the scripture that was read, reminds us that God's people are more than just making ends meet and doing daily chores and tasks. In verses 28 through 31, God tells his people that he's the one who is everlasting. Remember reading Francis Schaeffer back in the 70s, a theologian that wrote a book that God is there. And God reminds us that he's with us. So like when Krista was talking about her headache, that God answers prayer. Sometimes it's not in our timing, but he always answers. And you might have some concerns dealing with this COVID thing, some of the stressors with your job, some life issues that you have, maybe family things that are happening. God's there, and he wants to help you with those. I read an illustration about a lady that had some concerns about her family. She and her family weren't getting along very well. There were some issues popping up, and she was frustrated and anxious about that. Also at work, she had some concerns because they weren't really doing some of the things that she thought they should be doing. And she was kind of bummed by working in her office, and folks around her just had some issues that she didn't like, and so she was distraught about that. And also there were some other things happening with her life. She had some physical things happening. Well, she was moping like sometimes we do, and she was sitting at the coffee table one morning thinking about how life was not a good thing. And she happened to notice in her kitchen by the door, a little sparrow was there, and he somehow got in through the door, and he was in her kitchen on her floor. And so she went to open the door and thought, well, that sparrow's gonna fly out. And of course, the sparrow didn't, because he flew up and went towards the window above the door and kept crashing into the window. And every time he did, he lost a little more strength, and before long he couldn't fly up to the window, and he was down on the ground, and all he could do was walk. And she noticed that what he did was he walked right outside the door that was open, and before long he gained his strength and he flew away. And it reminded her that that's how God wants us to be, that sometimes our troubles, our problems, our concerns are something that we maybe can't handle, but God can. And when we trust Him, that He can make a way, that He can renew our strength, like the scriptures say. And we can mount up with wings like eagles, and we can walk and not be weary. Sometimes we walk and we're weary, but God says, trust me and I'll get you through this. I read an illustration by Joel Osteen, some of you know him, and it's about a signet ring, and he gave a little history about a signet ring back in the day, in Bible days, and in King some of the kings of England's day. But in Haggai it says, I will make you like my signet ring, God says, for I've chosen you. And in Isaiah, in 40, God says, I will renew your strength. And things are going to be different if you trust me. Well, we don't often hear about signet rings any longer, but it was the authority of the king that whoever had that ring could seal a letter or seal an edict or seal something that needed to get done. And it was the authority of that king that it could be done. And God is telling us, and he told the children of Israel, that I have my mark on you, that you're special, that you're chosen for a purpose, and I've given you power and authority. And this verse in Haggai is saying that you are the mark, and you have the mark of Almighty God on you, and that whatever comes your way, God already knows about it, and that He's going to make a way. And then I thought, as believers in Jesus, we have the seal as well. The blood of Christ on us, and the Holy Spirit, who's a witness in us that God's given to us as Christians to help us in life, that He's our comforter, and He's the one that gives us power, that we have access to that. So think about that this week when you face some things that maybe are beyond your control. Everything that God has is available to us as Christians. It could be healing. It could be provision, or strength, or peace, or joy. Maybe you haven't had that for a while. But God is saying that it's available. You've been given authority to sign His name. That when we pray, I don't know if you've noticed, but when we pray often, we pray in Jesus' name. And there's certain power that comes because God hears us and responds to that. So let me remind you that you have God's seal and you're marked to live the abundant life. Jesus said, I've come to give you life and give it abundantly. And He's come to give us joy as well. Let not your heart be troubled, God said. You believe in me, believe believe also, you believe in God, believe also in me. And Jesus said, I'll be with you always. We just celebrated Christmas, and the reminder in Christmas was Emmanuel, and we sang several songs about that. Emmanuel, God with us. God's with us today, and he wants us to be aware of that, that we're not the kind of folks that are walking this earth. We're special because of what God's done. Let me close with this illustration. Several years ago, an Eastern newspaper reported this story. One evening, a woman was driving home when she noticed a huge truck was following her, and it was uncomfortably close. She stepped on the gas to gain some distance from the truck, and she noticed that the truck sped up as well, and she couldn't seem to get away from that truck as she drove faster. Now she became scared, and so she exited the freeway, and the truck stayed with her, and the woman then turned on Main Street, hoping that somehow with all the people, that truck would leave her alone, the driver in that truck. Well, she reached the point of panic. The woman whipped her car into the service station and bolted out of her car, screaming for help. The truck driver sprang from his truck and ran toward the door of the car where the lady had just left. And in the back seat, he opened the door and he pulled out a guy that possibly was going to do harm to her. And she didn't notice that. The woman had run away from the wrong person. The person that was trying to help her was the truck driver behind her, and she didn't even know it. And when you think about it, that's kind of how God is in our lives, that we think that all the things around us are causing some problems, which they might, but we don't turn to God necessarily first, and he wants us to. We've been created in the image of God, but men all around us make us think that sometimes we're chickens, that we're living among the chickens. God wants to remind us this day and this week that we're not. You're eagles. That you can have strength beyond yourself. That when you're weary, God will give you just what you need when we trust him. Amen. Holy Father, we thank you for the reminders that you give us that you love us, and that when we're weary with the effects of life and pressures and even sin, that when we turn to you, you show us the way and you forgive us. Lord, please help us to soar on wings like eagles this week. May we walk in faith and victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's sing our last song. Thank you. disciples walked with Christ so long ago, so now you walk with Christ in your hearts, in your spirits. Feel the power of the Holy Spirit guiding your path. Know the love of God, which is poured out for you, and rejoice. Go in peace, and may God's power go with you. Amen. Thank you.